everybody. I was even trying to beat Chris at the 2001 Iron Man. Mm. You know, I told
him. And what about? And then here's a funny one. I'll tell you a real funny one. I know Mal remember this shit because I tell this story all the time. But
yeah,
which is well documented. And we was up in San Francisco. I remember Mel. I was talking to Melvin backstage. I haven't seen you for a minute, but Melvin started doing his own thing, doing the shows and doing his guest poses and becoming into his own. I remember we was backstage and he was like, "Yeah, man, I'm glad you got a handle on that shit, man. This and that." And I was like, "Yeah, man, So we was like, we was going up to the stage. We got the first call out with each other, like head to head, basically. And So they called me up there. I forgot who else they called up there. I mean, they called, and they said, "Melvin Anthony on the right." And then Melvin get up there. He basically like bumped me with his elbow when he came up there. Like, he's like, "I've been waiting my whole life for this."
Oh, like, he was fantastic. Fantastic.
Look, he said that shit. I looked at Melvin.
Yeah, Chris, look here. Chris,
I'm like, "What? You been wait, what?" I was like, I went, boom, we went through our shit. Boom, boom, hitting shots. They said, "Chris, come here, back in line. Such and such, take their place." And I was like, "All right, see you later, Melvin." And then I walked away. And then he was like, "Damn." Like, he had another call out to She was like, "Yo." He's like, "I've been waiting my whole life. Like, he's about to take me out." Like, I'm like,
he's getting close.
He's like, "Wait your whole life for this, what?"
I helped you.
My boy, I guess I gotta try to beat my boy.
I know.
As soon as they said Chris Cormier back a lot, he's like, "I'll see you later." I was like, "Fuck."
I was like, "Not today, Melvin. Not today.
I tried to get him at the 2001 Iron Man too, boy. I tried to get him. He was like, "Man, you ain't gonna get me today. You ain't ready. And on the stage, people don't know that bodybuilders talk to each other up there. We talk to each other up there. So if people don't know that what's going on, they can just see facial movements. And we talking back to the bicep. Chris going to talk about, "This is my shot." I said, "Mine too. Back lat spread." He said, he talked to me the whole time, trying to psych me out. Look, you can't psych me out. But when it was all said and done at the end, I knew Chris was going to get me. You know what I'm talking about? But boy, I tried to take it. Believe 2001, I tried to get his ass. I tried to get him. That was just a common thing, for young guys to be able to beat their sensei. It's just like the karate movie Kung Fu.
Yeah.
When you take the rock from my hands and say, then you will become a master. I never got the rock from Chris, but I got it from Flex, but
Yeah.
So it was just us growing up that way. I learned so much from Chris, and a lot of those guys, they were very open to talk to each other and help each other. Yeah. Nowadays guys don't even talk to each other. These youngsters don't even know who people are. You know what I mean? It's crazy how it changed from how we came through and how I came through.
Yeah.
The market is how it is now. These youngsters, they're afraid to call Chris. They're afraid to tell me or call me or ask me questions. They're afraid to see us. When they see us, some of the guys are like, "I'm a pro," but they don't know who went before you. You could never know what your future gonna be like if you don't know your past. A lot of these young guys.
Yeah. Do you ever think of a sense of like some of the guys that compete today? Like, I feel like this is the most you should be able to reach out to anybody in the world, basically, and be like, how do you see this? I see this training like this or this posing like this. Like I would, man, if we had social media back when we were young, I guarantee you, I'd have been all up in Lee Haney's gym.
Oh, yeah.
I would have been all up in, I would have been doing, I've been doing the most, man, I guarantee you, but we was already in touch with, Joe Weider was alive still at that time. And we went as high as we can go with connection or with, having just a conversation even.
Right.
But I guarantee you, I would have been in a lot of people's ears that you couldn't.
One name I hear a lot, obviously, with like Sean Ray, you've mentioned it, is John Brown. That's a name that I've heard so many times. Like, you mentored Melvin, Chris. John Brown, he really was a mentor to people like yourself, Chris.
Well, he was kind of in all of our lives in one facet or another. But he was like, we basically, I could say, was all under his umbrella. I could say that. Just from being a showman on stage and your attitude off the stage and all that stuff. Because when I was in junior college, I moved up to Fullerton and I was training in the same gym as John Brown when I was 18 years old. Mm-hmm. So I saw him firsthand, you know, handling 150 pound dumbbells on a preacher curl, straining at that, you know, hitting maybe two or three reps, but he's doing 130 pound preacher curls.
Mm-hmm.
Same guy.
That dude was strong as hell.
And you know, he had been to Europe. He got that European flair. He made us all want to go to Europe. You know what I'm saying? He made us all want to, you know what I'm saying? Coming home with, you know, boatloads of money and stuff from Europe and going on tour and stuff like that. So that was in our mind as amateurs. That's what we want. You know, we want to do that stuff.
Yeah, he would tell you straight. That guy, people didn't want to ask him a lot of questions. He was so blunt. You know, he told me that he said that I had a blend of a Roy Callender, Flex Wheeler, some other guy, Serge Nebraish kind of look to me.
I can see that. The thing is, Melvin, I think probably one of your best poses is that first compulsory pose. That's the front double bicep. And the way you angled your body, you gave a very, very good, strong first impression when you were called out in the judging.
Right. And I had to learn that. I mean, John had to show me how to battle, you know, and Chris showed me some other things also. But, you know, John wouldn't mess with us. When it came to posing, man, it was serious business. And he said, you got to do what they want. You got to do what they want because you're going to always run into a guy that's better and bigger. Mm-hmm. So when you run into a bigger guy, you better know you got to know what you got, your best assets, and know how to use them.
So you can believe that he spent some time with all of us at certain times.
All of us.
Sometimes all of us at one time, you know, we was around, but it was definitely under his umbrella for sure.
Yeah. Even Victor Richards, man, was like a baby when he was in front of John. Sir, yes, sir. Man, that boy don't call nobody sir. Victor Richards did what he wanted to do. But Chris, hey, how you doing, sir? How you doing, sir? I'm like, man, Victor Richards bowed down to John. What the? He said, but I told you, I train everybody. Vic, you know, Vince Taylor, all those guys. Vince Taylor, Victor Richards.
And he had some really cool clothes at the time, too. So he had the tights with the two stripes on the side, then the major lift.
Jay Brown.
Extra big. He had the curls for the girls. He had the shirts with the curls for the girls.
Curls for the girls.
Fantastic. I love it.
You remember that shirt?
Wow. Yeah.
Is it, guys?
Station shirt with the Jay Brown on it.
Cut-off
sleeves.
Is it true that he was the one that started the idea for Phoebo?
Yes.
That's incredible. Because I heard John, and I was like, it was never confirmed.
John Brown was the first one to offer that idea, and they didn't want to pick it up from him. They didn't want it. They would, oh, yeah. And then years, yep. Then they messed around, did it on their own. But John was the first one to put that out there.
Wow!
Why don't you just do that for everybody?
He was now a pioneer. He was a pioneer.
Yeah. I remember with Serge Debray, I met Serge Debray for the first time, and I had told Chris about it. I was like, man, remember when Serge Debray came down and he saw me? I didn't know he was in there. I walked in the gym.
Wow.
And Chris was down over in Fountain Valley training, and I said, man, guess who up in the gym right now, man? Serge Debray. Oh, he's like, oh yeah, me is a good dude, man. So I said, good dude, man. Talk to him if you can.
Yeah.
Chris told me to talk to him. So, you know, I'm in there training. And he saw me and he asked John, who's that dude right there, man? That's a specimen. He goes, that's my guy, man. You know what I'm saying? That's Mark. Yeah, good.
Sergio, as old as he was still wearing string tank tops. That was his uniform.
Still in shape.
Tank top and them little shorts.
Yeah.
He's showing everything every day.
Everything. He had everything hanging out. That's whole package up there. But you know, he walked up to me and he's like, he said, hey Melvin, you have a phenomenal physique. I looked at him like, what? Like, who is this nigga? Are you trying to be like put some smoke in my head? Come on. He's like, you have a phenomenal. John, tell me a little bit about you. I want you to come to me with friends. I want you to.
Serge Debray.
Oh my! I'm not gonna go no France with you. I don't know how to fly nowhere. So he's like, "Yes, I want you to come train for a few months. I want to show you some things, right?" So after he got done, I called Chris and said, "Man, Chris, man, Serge, man, he's trying to get me to go to France, man." He's like, "Man, you should think about it, man. You know, it'd be an opportunity." John said, "No, you ain't going no damn France." That boy, he said that boy trains. You gonna miss around, come running back, because that boy trains crazy. He don't never come out. He live in the gym.
Yeah.
He said Serge Dupre ate, slept, and trained in the gym. He never left the gym. He trained 4 or 5 times a day.
What?
Eat, go back to the gym. Eat, go back to the gym. He said, I know your ass ain't gonna do that. So you might not want to rethink that one. That's the only reason why that girl was afraid. I was like, man, I don't know if I can handle that. Just going to the gym and go home, eat, go back to the gym, go eat, go home. I came out and said, Chris, I ain't going to go, man. I ain't going to go, man. I'm going to stay here.
Do that for a few months in France. Wow.
We also had a great time in Australia with Tony Doherty took care of us.
Yeah.
We'd fly over to Australia and compete, and we hanging out. And like I said, we had like little apartments over there at that time. We'll be hanging on. It's cool because, you know, coming from watching him as a, you know, just winning the California show and the way we met and the way, you know, we kept it together throughout, you know, turning pro and then that whole transition on into, you know, all the different things. I mean, I remember I went to, I went to Melvin's graduation for cosmetology school. All that shit.
Oh, you mean the
doing nails? Hell yeah!
Melvin's doing nails and stuff. I'm like, okay.
I gotta make money, man.
Explain.
I went to the graduation. I'm like, and Melvin got up there, got a certificate. I'm like, speech. Melvin, nobody did a speech, but I'm all Melvin up there about speech, stand speech.
Christmas was a day, always with the
He was so embarrassed, too.
I was so embarrassed. I made so much money. Everybody's like, man.
What was that, the Tom Cruise thing?
He was the biggest nail tech. In the world. He was the biggest one.
Nail tech in the world. I'm like 240. I had my
nobody was doing nails at that size. Look at Joe's face.
I'm sorry. I'm a bit lost now. You've lost me now.
I know how to do a whole lot of stuff, man, guys. I know how to do a lot. Look, I was doing nails, man. You just can't imagine what girls tell you while you're rubbing their feet. he said to me about how come my man doing this, and I want the male perspective, you know what I'm talking about? So you know, yeah, I made a lot of them females doing them nails, boy. Believe me, I was knocking them down.
I'm like, going around offering it shit. He's like, hey, let me do your feet.
Let me do your feet, girl. Got you.
Oh, nails.
Rubbing on
nails, right? Nail technician.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. When you say nails, I was like, what the hell's he on about?
Yeah, we're talking about pedicures, manicures. You know what I'm talking about?
Right,
you know,
okay. Beautiful.
Yeah, I was killing them. I was all at the show at the Olympia talking about, girl, you break a nail, I got you. I'm going to.
I got you.
I'm running around there acting a fool, boy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
So what was it like? Because you did the 2001 Grand Prix tour together, didn't you? What was that like? Because you said you came to Manchester and we spoke a bit before we started filming. What was that like?
And for me,
I was at that one as well because I was sat right in the front.
Yeah, in Manchester, man.
Yeah,
it was new for me. You know, I mean, traveling like that. Chris had to show me a lot. You know, some of the other guys around me, you know, would tell me a lot. Even Dennis would tell me, you know, certain things. I wasn't used to traveling like that. You know, I really had to be tutored because being on a plane and trying to stay with your diet is crazy difficult. You can't eat what they eat. You can't eat hot food. You know, when you get there, you got to go find the stuff you need. Some of us, y'all don't eat the same as like we eat in America. You guys can eat a little different. And Chris would always, you know, try to tell us how to get ready, the travel, you know, put your body.